How's it going, people? Welcome back to the channel and welcome back to another Box to Box. Arsenal are not in great form at the moment. Three of the last three, we've lost 0 out of 9 points, and we're coming here Wednesday night, Stamford Bridge against Chelsea. I've got Matisse with me, fellow Big Six member. What are you saying, Matisse?
Come on, it's good to be back. Do you know what I'm saying? Good timing as well, because I was keeping myself hush hush quiet. You know what I'm saying?
I see that.
Wouldn't hear a peep out of me this weekend, because obviously there was a madness going on in North London. But I said, let me settle myself, because we got a little thing to deal with at Wembley, and thankfully we got through it. So now I can be here present with you in a good state.
Yeah, so it's been a mad few weeks for Chelsea. Return from international break, that Brentford result.
Yeah.
The first leg of the Real Madrid game, obviously the second leg, and the fight and spirit shown made up some of that, I guess. You know, Tuchel's been under a bit of pressure. Talk to me about Tuchel. Has that pressure been warranted, Matisse? You know, considering he's been to the majority of his finals, all but one since he's been at Chelsea Football Club, and that's something that you hold highly.
Yeah, I think people have kind of misconstrued, or you know, kind of put two things together. When obviously the fans, we all had our expectations, come for us, crucify us. We thought we were going to win the league and Lukaku was going to be top scorer. But you got to put that into context and separate that with Tuchel's performance. Because for me, Tuchel's in his first year, first full season, and he's got us to every single final outside of the Champions League this season. Yeah. So that is an incredible achievement. And when you put it into context, and I don't like to make excuses, but it's just context for me. Injuries, you know, in the winter period definitely played a part. If you say that you're going to take out Kante, Jorginho, Kovar, Reece James and Chilwell out of your team, you're not going to rehab a midfield and you're not going to have any wing backs. And there's, you know, COVID's going on, there's cases flying about, there's some cases in the squad. And we're playing, we didn't have a COVID break. I think we were the only team not to have one.
True.
Yes, we have a big squad. We should be dealing with that better. But unfortunately, the squad depth is not doing the business. They're not as good as the starters. And when you look at the profile of those players, the people coming in, they just can't do the job. Do you know what I'm saying? It's not the same thing. So when I look at it, I say to myself, listen, under context, he's kind of finishing similar positions to where we were finishing for the last 4 or 5 years. Lampard, Sarri, Conte's last season, you know, fourth, third, fifth. That's where we've been. We've never been in a title race since we won it in 2017. Yeah. So he's not underperforming in the league. He's just hasn't kicked us on. But to say that he hasn't kicked us on in his first full season, I think that's a fair shout, considering Pep, Klopp, when they came in.
Yeah.
Great managers, world-class managers. They've shown what they can do. Tuchel's got to show that. But they didn't win the league in their first year either.
Yeah.
Liverpool had a worse squad, City had a better one. We're kind of hovering in the middle. So for me personally, I just think with everything going on, stewardship, ownership, Lukaku situation to deal with, like I said, that period in the winter, I think he's dealt with everything spot on. Come for us. Come for us. I hear it in the comments. I hear what you're saying already. Excuses. But for Tuchel, these situations that he's dealing with, it's a bit unprecedented for us, and it's a very good job that he's doing.
And I remember you speaking on Big Six earlier this season when you said, I think it's time for Chelsea to renew their approach to things. Maybe go to a more, not sustainable, because you have been sustainable recently in terms of your loans and your, you know, being shrewd in the market.
Yeah.
But you want to, you know, find a new path for Chelsea. You want that, you know, youth players coming in and then adding the salt on top and you know, finishing off.
A little bit of paprika, some basil, do you know what I'm saying? Just a little couple spices, because when you've got an academy like this, you have to take advantage. And my issue with Chelsea right now, before the new ownership, hopefully things change, is that we're obviously using the academy to at times make money. Yes, we've got Mason in there. Yes, we've got, you know, Christensen, we've got Reece James, but we've also got Gerhi at Palace, who's captaining them and doing madness. We've also got, you know, Lamptey, Livramento, Gallagher out on loan, Brody out on loan. We can still do more. We can still be better. Tomori's keeping clean sheets for fun in a title race in Serie A whilst we have centre-backs running out of contract.
Yeah, yeah.
So we're not run in this, like, I know people will look at it and say, how many trophies in how many years? But if you look at Chelsea in the last 5 years, there is a decline. Yes, we're still winning things, a Champions League, a Europa League under Sarri. But when you're talking about consistency in the league, like I said, we haven't been in competing for the title. This is our longest stint under the old ownership without a title.
Yeah,
so you have to analyse that, look at that and say, 5 years could become 10 years if you don't keep yourself in check, because Liverpool and Manchester City, top to bottom, are pretty well aligned and sorted, and they have a very clear vision. So it's very easy to get, you know, complacent as a fan base and say, we're winning trophies, but next thing you know, it's 10 years past certain club in Manchester you know, they're getting there, and next thing you know, you haven't even won a league, and it's like, whoa, what happened? Where'd the time go?
It's coming up to 20 for us, so
even though
it's 10 for Manchester, I know exactly what you're talking about. Listen, you lot have just made an FA Cup final. Your league position is pretty certain. You're going to be top four. It seems like you're going to be third in the league. There's a little cushion there. Is there a chance you take your eye off the ball in this game, or is it about the best possible preparation for this FA Cup final now?
For me, can't take our eye off the ball. Have to stay concentrated, focused. I say concentrated like juice. That's what I always say. Because I want that to be like my little sister makes it, where you just spit out. It's like too strong. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
I want us to go absolutely all out, because we haven't got the FA Cup final until, you know, mid-May. So it's a whole month. So in a month now, you can't just be chilling. We're not on the beach. For me, I always look at points, and I say, if we're not going to win the league, I want us to close the points gap to Manchester City and Liverpool. I want it to be respectable. 7 points, 6 points. We can only do that by winning games and being up there. And also, if we want to say that we're not on the level of an Arsenal, Manchester United, Tottenham, then we need to show that in the points gap. I always say points over position, because I remember when Man United finished second under Ollie, and everyone was like, Man United finished second. It's not the same second as Liverpool, who got 97 points and were right up there challenging. Yeah. You can't analyse those two seasons and say they're the same. And we saw the drop off from one, and the other's still chilling. So that's how I see it. And I say to myself, if we want to, and also players, you know, they have to play their part. If they want to play in the FA Cup final, don't go on the beach for a month, because otherwise you ain't going to get in the starting 11. So they've got to go and showcase what they can do against Arsenal. And we haven't got a great record. You did a double over us last year. Yeah. So there should be some motivation to say, we actually need to beat these guys. We need to show that we are better than them. Same with Manchester United. We got a poor record against them recently as well. Ollie had our number. Don't know why.
Yeah.
Because I'm pretty sure his number was blocked. You know what I'm saying? But it is what it is. So that's how we've got to move. We have to be serious, 100%.
Talking about pressure on Tuchel, I want to talk about Mikel Arteta as well.
Yeah.
Throughout this season, you know, I talk to you twice a week, every week on Big Six. Mm. You've given praise when Arteta's deserved praise, especially in recent times from February to April.
Yeah.
But you've also been critical at times too.
Yep.
What seems to be an end of season collapse is upon us, you know. Three losses against three teams that beforehand we would have all expected a bare minimum of 7, if not 9 points.
Yeah.
What's your opinions on Mikel Arteta and what seemed like a turnaround this season? Has it fallen flat on his face, or is there still things to take out of it?
There's definitely stuff to take out of it. However, I am absolutely shocked with the recent run of form. I'm not going to lie. As much as I banter Arsenal, I said to myself, okay, Palace, that can happen. But you're also playing two other teams that are mid-table, on the beach, on the coast. And I said to myself, well, Arsenal should beat those teams. Because at this stage of the season, you'd much rather play teams in mid-table who are not really fighting for anything.
Yeah.
And they're kind of just going through the motions over the relegation
Very
teams.
Good point. All the teams challenging.
Yeah, yeah, because they're fighting for their lives and, you know, money's at stake now and, you know, all this kind of sacking managers and manager bounces leads, you know, yep. Burnley have just sacked Sean Dyche. These things are happening at lower levels of the league. Whereas mid-tables, everybody's calm, everybody's chilling. So for Arsenal to lose all of those games against teams that are, you know, quite calm, that is shocking for me. That's not good.
Throws a spanner in the works.
It does, and it doesn't set yourselves up well for more competitive fixtures to come against teams that are still trying to do stuff, but are just like a higher point in the league and have more quality. With Arteta, when I was praising him, I said, you know what, he deserves his praise, because you've beaten Wolves, you've beaten Aston Villa, done a double over Wolves. These are teams that you can't disrespect, because they're having good seasons, they're tough to play against, and they've beaten other big sides. And I said, you know what, the resilience on show, the performances sometimes are not always complete, but that's good, the fact that you're actually able to go through and grind out a result. That should be praised, because Arsenal over the years, we've been criticising them for not being able to do that. But now you've got to keep that going. And I look at it and I say to myself, is there a bit of inexperience? You know, manager, Definitely. Players, the best players are the young ones. They've never been in a top four race before. Maybe the pressure from the fan base, everybody's excited. I'm seeing comps on Twitter with the UEFA Champions League. You know what I'm saying? The song's being sung, Saka's knee slide. I'm saying, oh, aren't these guys giddy? It's not done yet, guys, concentrate.
Far from.
Yeah, and the players are maybe, you know what I mean, they're feeling that, and maybe they might choke because it is the first time in this position. So I think it's a bit mad, but yeah, Arsenal at the moment, they have to get themselves sorted, because you can't afford to finish outside the top four this season. For me, otherwise he should be sacked, because when you look at Tottenham, that's not a team you expect to finish below. You have to capitalize on this opportunity.
Yeah.
And if you don't do that, then you know you have to act accordingly. For me, I'm looking at it, I'm saying, you've got yourselves into a position to challenge. You haven't sealed the deal. And how many times do we say to ourselves, opportunists, you have to take the opportunity when it comes, and they're not doing that. So, you know, that's a situation where you have to sort yourselves out 100%.
January. Mm. Big window for Arsenal. Well, it was meant to be a big window.
Yeah.
We went into the new year in top four. We had just beaten West Ham a few weeks prior. And at that stage of the season, everyone was saying West Ham deserved to be top four.
Yeah.
We beat them, leap above them in the table. Everyone seems to be thinking and saying Arsenal deserve to have that position.
Yeah.
And January calmed, you get knocked out two domestic cups. How big was not bringing anyone in January? Because I've rattled on about it now, especially after the three losses, because the depth, the young side, the pressure on their shoulders, the burden of getting back into the Champions League.
Yeah.
For me, it's not fair.
No, it's huge. I mean, I was looking at January transfer window. Who's going to capitalize? Who's going to improve their squad and get serious for Champions League? Because you can get that money back in a few months if you take it serious. Champions League money is huge. Tottenham brought in Kulusevski. They brought in Bentancur. Arsenal didn't bring in anyone. They got rid of a lot of players, but they didn't bring in anyone. So I can't look at Arsenal and say, oh, our depth isn't... You had depth, but you got rid of it and you didn't replace it. You shrunk your squad.
Yeah.
And then now suddenly you've got a few injuries and it's starting to, you know, starting to show itself up. And I say to myself, if Arsenal don't make top four as well, didn't invest in January, didn't really seize the opportunity, like I said, you're not in Europe. You're not tied to the FA Cup in the third round. You've had this to focus on. And if you don't seal the deal when you've got just this to focus on, I'm looking at it and I'm saying to myself, how are you going to do it next year when you're in Europe and Ten Hag's in charge and Conte's got a full season and still Tuchel, Klopp, Pep, and all these managers are clear of Arteta. Arteta for me is like a mid-table level manager.
Because you don't know any better because this is his first stint.
Exactly. But these guys are all better than him. Now he's got Europe to contend with. Twice a week, travelling, easy jet flights. Do you know what I'm saying? Phil's mm-hmm. kicking you in the back of the seat. Martinelli's fuming. It's long. These are the things that are going to come into play when we talk about Arsenal Football Club next year. It's not happening this year. Right now, it's Brexit. Do you know what I'm saying? It's literally stay home, stay inside, stay indoors. That's what you guys are doing.
Brexit and COVID in
That's
one.
That's what I'm saying. But listen, if you don't seal the deal, you will be in Europe regardless. So you have to get serious right now.
Yeah, because for me, you know, people like to say it would have been ahead of schedule making top four this year, but that's a debate about standards and that's for another day, because I'm sure I'm gonna have that in the next few weeks and months to come until next season.
Yeah.
But next season now, the importance is so great that I struggle to see an inexperienced manager like Mikel Arteta achieving it. And what I'm more so, you know, seeing is next season going down the drain too, because we've got a manager that's learning.
Yeah.
And that's not his fault, you know. He's got to learn somewhere. It just happens to be that he's learning at Arsenal Football Club during a time where the pressure and the burden of going back into Europe and getting back to challenge him. Because Arteta says it himself, you know, third, second, first, that's the targets. It's not necessarily just making top four.
Yeah.
So we've got to hold them same high standards.
Yeah.
And for me, the process comes from above. That's why January for me was such a letdown, because trying and failing is completely different to not trying and failing.
Yeah.
You know,
100%. At least you can say, you can look back on it and say, we gave it our absolute. Do you know what I'm saying? That's how I look back at the Real Madrid tie. I say, you know what? We got us handed to us in the first leg, but at least we came back and I can come out of that competition and say, you know what? Fair enough. We actually competed. And the way I see it is that when you look at Arsenal and you say to yourself, right, this is an opportunity. Yes, it might be overachieving because I didn't have it in the top four. You didn't have it in the top four. But Man United, they were sleeping. Sleeping giant. Yeah. So take advantage.
Who assumed that was going to happen?
Yeah, no one assumed that when they signed Ronaldo, Sancho. But take advantage of that. Someone's got to replace them.
Yeah.
Leicester have tried to make it. West Ham have always tried to make it. They're overachieving. But that's a good thing. If you're going to achieve anything in football, in life, sometimes you have to overachieve. If everybody just went about saying, this is what is expected of me, this is what I expect, then no one would get to the high heights, because ain't nobody expected me to be here.
Yeah, yeah.
I ain't going to lie. Mum said stay in college. I said, Mum, look, now look what. What now? Do you know what I'm saying?
You got a mic in
this
your
is
hand.
Do you know what I'm saying? But now, like, we're pushing, we're moving somewhere. But this is what it is in life. You have to overachieve. Arsenal Football Club, with the process, sixth last season. Sorry, should have been after an eighth, but back to back eighth is underachieving. So the way I see it is, it should have been 8-6-4. Do you know what I'm saying? Just quick maths. 8-8, you're underachieving. Now six is looking great. I don't think so.
We're behind schedule more so than ahead. Yeah, so let's look at the game, man. Wednesday night, we're back here. You lot are in the FA Cup final. We're coming off of three losses in a row. Big injury for you guys in the Crystal Palace game. Kovacic come off in the first half. He's someone outside looking in that it seemed that this is his season. Jorginho has been getting credit for the past year, year and a half. Kante's got an awful lot of credit over the past 2, 3, 4, 5 years.
Yeah.
Kovacic this season, under the radar, has become an integral part of your system and what Tuchel wants to do. How big a loss is that?
Huge. He's carrying our midfield. He really is, like, on his back. He's the most consistent midfielder, and for me, he's the best midfielder. Two reasons. Obviously, one player of the year in 2019, I believe, under Frank. That's very underspoken about. Very good season from him. This season, again, best midfielder.
Yeah.
Those other two, they've had high heights, very high heights. Champions League run incredible. But over the longevity of a whole season, their performances are very much dipping. Their influence is dipping. And they're not showing the consistent high level that we need, down to injuries or being overplayed, not having people in their position position to keep them competitive. They obviously play for their national teams. It's not just their fault, but they're also getting older as well.
Yeah.
So, but Kovar is in that prime age, 27, and he suits our style of play best because on and off the ball, he's mobile. He can get stuck into challenges, but he can also pass the ball. He can dribble. Do you know what I'm saying? He's also a little bit got an aggressive side to him.
Yeah.
Whereas the other two, Kante, final third, is no use to us. Can't play the final pass, can't shoot. When you take a look at Jorginho, mobility-wise, he needs cover, he needs protection, he can be exposed in transition. Kovar kind of is a well-rounded, balanced player. Yeah. And when you look at the best midfields, I feel like they are very well-balanced. We talk about obviously being able to do things at the top level, whether it be passing, Football Manager, people looking for statistics of 19 and 20 for certain attributes. But them players that can do everything to like a 15, 16, they're very they're integral to your team.
Yeah.
Because you know you can count on them in all phases of play. It makes you more flexible formation-wise and tactically. If you've got guys that are very specific, they work in certain scenarios. But then when you put them into other scenarios, they absolutely fall off a cliff. Yeah. So he's a huge miss. But Loftus-Cheek has been stepping up recently.
Yeah, he could play.
Yeah. Yeah, big impact, huge impact. And he's a player that everybody's got love for in the Chelsea fan base. You know, we just want to see him do well. I personally want to see him do well here or anywhere else. I'm not one of these guys, Channel 4, hoarding talents and that, you know what I'm saying? Back room, you got like Jamal Blackman and whatnot. And, you know what I'm saying? Like, let them go and do their thing. If they're not playing here and they're not regular members, especially when we've got that affiliation to them as Cobham graduates, I want to see them go and boss it at Roma and AC Milan and show everybody why Cobham's the best. I don't want to see them on the Chelsea bench, fourth string midfielder, waiting for their chance if they're not going to really get it. But he's been involved recently, which is good.
And luckily for you guys, look, you said Kovac is a huge loss. I mean, Thomas Partey, you can see how huge a loss he's been. And the middle of the park without him just lacks that quality for sure.
Yeah.
High level of experience is another one. I know Xhaka's of the age where, you know, experience comes into play, but not all experience is good experience.
Yeah.
So that part of the pitch, it'll be interesting to see who wins that battle because you're missing a huge talent, we're missing a huge talent. Looking at Arsenal, Matisse, you know, in terms of you lot getting a win here Wednesday night, who do you need to nullify?
Saka. 100% Saka. Martinelli's a threat. 100% rate him. I rate all your young players, you know. It's actually the experienced ones that are probably letting you down, the lack of professionalism over the years and all these things. But Saka is a danger because Alonso's on that side. And Rudiger's also on that side, so that helps. But Alonso can be beaten. He's not the quickest. And Saka's pretty good at dribbling. Obviously, he wants to cut inside and cause problems. And I think he's one of your most influential players going forward, going with the goals and whatnot. He's had a good season. Some people may be talking about a different player this season, aren't they?
Potentially. I mean, I think he's joint top scorer with Emil at the moment. 9 goals each. I think he's got 5 assists. So he's been our most productive in terms of goals and assists.
It's a lot of pressure to put on young shoulders, but they have stood up. They just need to close the deal, which is going to be difficult. But Saka's definitely the main threat. The rest of the defence, you know, Reece James locked up Zaha, he locked up Vinicius, Vinicius didn't dribble past him once. When he did get the assist for the goal, it was other defenders he was getting past. So Reece James is in serious, serious form. So I expect that side to be locked up, and centre-back Rudiger, you know, Christiansen had a great game against Palace in the semi-final. I expect if they play to their level, I don't think your forwards can eclipse that and go above and beyond when they're on their day. Especially when I'm seeing Nketiah
not
really getting no goals. I don't think he has any Premier League goals this season, does he? So that's a problem. Do you know what I'm saying? That could be a bit toothless up top if he doesn't change things for me.
A bit toothless.
I think Martinelli personally should be starting up top if I was to look at it on that side of things, because I say to myself, if Nketiah is not a goal scorer and he's not getting goals, which he clearly isn't, at least you know Martinelli can finish, and then maybe incorporate a Pepe back into the team.
A lot of the fans are saying similar, to be honest.
But there you go.
Maybe try something different out.
Yeah,
let's get into prediction. It's a difficult one for me because I'm at that stage of the season now with Arsenal where I think it's all over. I think those 3 losses have done the damage, and I think going to Chelsea away is not ideal. But then again, I thought going to Brighton and going to Southampton in the form they was in would have been ideal, and it wasn't to be.
Yeah.
What's your prediction for the Wednesday night?
My prediction would be a 2-0 Chelsea win. I'm confident. However, I'm aware that you beat us twice. I'm aware that we sometimes like to be charitable and, you know, a little bit of Thanksgiving. A little bit April Fools when it's not even the first and things like that. So we got to be careful. We need to take you seriously. And I'm always screaming no complacency. I've been screaming it for months because this Chelsea team isn't perfect. They have their flaws. But we are, when we play to our maximum, and Tuchel said that, we have to play at 100%. We can't play at 80 or 75 and still do the business because technically we're not as strong as like a Man City. Yeah. But if we play at 100, we're one of the best teams. And we've shown that when we compete with Liverpool 3 times this season, 3 draws in normal time. So we're a very good team when we play at our best. People saw it against Real Madrid as well. We need to be switched on. We need to play properly. But I just think when I look at Arsenal, them couple injuries, Partey, Tierney, and now we're starting to see that lack of squad depth. And I'm saying to myself, if Arsenal were in Europe this year and they had that squad depth that they currently have, playing twice a week, like I said, where would Arsenal be? Maybe similar to where they've been, 7th, 8th. That's the thing, where you look at West Ham, they got a strong 11 too, good team. But that, if you look at Arsenal, West Ham's record after Europa League games, shocking recently because of that squad depth and the lack of ability to rotate Antonio and Declan Rice. Same issue with Arsenal, just you're playing once a week, so you've been able to recover, recuperate these things. So I'm looking at Arsenal, I'm saying to myself, yeah, there's, we could definitely get out of them 100%.
2-0, I'm going 3-1 Chelsea.
Damn.
Bro, do you blame me?
No, I don't.
I don't even know what to
You're doing this like predictions league, like you're not even bothering with the...
No, 3-1, 3-1 later on Big Six, this is my prediction. I just think, if people think, you know, Monday night against Crystal Palace away is difficult, then Wednesday night against Chelsea is not any easier. And I just think, I haven't seen enough in terms of fixing the transition when Partey's not there, when Tierney's not there.
Yeah.
You know, two players have just come out and it just seems like we're lost at times. So I just think Chelsea will get the job done. You're on a bit of a high, you've made the FA Cup final. Like I said, your top three spot is secure.
Yeah.
I think you'll get the job done. Before we go, there was a video that me and Robbie done a few months ago where he asked me about some strikers that I wouldn't mind seeing at the club.
Yeah? Oh, mad.
And I put a list of about 8, 9, 10 strikers. And there was one in particular that Robbie turned around to me and said, what? Werner?
You know what? A funny one that I'd actually go for. Timo Werner. I'd go for Timo Werner. Timo Werner, why not? Why not?
Werner!
That's this. Werner's a good player, bro. It just hasn't worked out for him at Chelsea. It just hasn't worked
Timo
out
Timo Werner?
Yes. Do you know what he was before Chelsea, Rob? Would you have taken him before Chelsea?
Yeah, but now I've seen the light.
And I remember that day, people, I actually messaged Matisse.
He did.
As soon as that finished, I messaged Matisse. I said, yo, because I thought, I'm not going mad. I said, Matisse, is Werner like a decent option if Arsenal, you know, wanted to bring something? Matisse was like, nah. No, but in recent weeks, though, Werner and... He always starts for Tuchel as well, especially in the biggest games.
Yeah.
So surely there's something there with him that, you know.
His minutes contributed has actually been a lot lower than last year. So people are kind of saying, well, he hasn't been given as many opportunities to score. But I always say, listen, if someone's not getting many chances, they must not be very good. I don't look at Ross Barkley and say, why aren't you playing? Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, you haven't got many minutes for your GA. I say, good. Do you know what I'm saying? Happy days. Now, with the thing is with Werner is that he's a very specific type of player. He could work for you, but he's mainly a guy that works in two striker systems, so you'd have to change up the way you play a bit. He is a last line of defence kind of guy. What's the dimensions of Emirates Stadium? Is it a big pitch? Cool. That's a big thing. We're joking about it right now, but Stamford Bridge is quite tight, it's quite small, compact. This is a gazelle. He needs to run in the field, he needs to be able to have a loose touch and do all these things. If you ain't got a big pitch and you ain't playing high lines, it's a long day for him. Now, if you play against high lines sometimes and you have a big pitch, then he might be of better use to you guys. But I must say, he's on 270k a week. So I always look at that's it from bad, a value for money. That's I don't bad. Like to watch people's pockets, but now that we broke, you know what I mean? When I'm broke, I don't go into Starbucks and order everything. Yeah. Do you know what I'm saying? I go into Costa and get a little mini coffee and that. So 270k a week, value for money wise, is it really there? For me, absolutely not. £47 million, absolutely not. 9 Premier League goals in 2 seasons. His Champions League record is good. The tempo is different there. It's a bit more open. There's a bit high. There's, you know, it's a bit more expansive in the play. But Premier League, away from home, low blocks. This is where he's not strong. You know, he's not the most tight technically. He, in small spaces, he can have a loose touch. He doesn't dribble the best all the time. He's a bit of a kick it and run kind of guy. So if you're willing to have someone who's quite specific for moments, but for the course of a whole season, the only person that can save him is Klopp. Do you know what I'm saying? That's a brother that turns everybody into goal scorers. Arteta's attacking, you know, abilities as a coach.
Yeah.
Listen, if you couldn't get Aubameyang doing it, then problem. I don't know, bro.
No, I just thought I'd get that in there, people. Matisse, thank you for coming on, my guy.
Of course.
Appreciate it. Listen, Matisse's channel is in the title. Link's in the description below as well. And as you already know, Big Six twice a week, every week. Look out for that, people. And as always, love for the love. Hit the like button on the way out. Score predictions below, lineups, all of that. We're out. Peace.
Shop for AFTV merch at shop.aftv.co.uk. Subscribe to us on YouTube. Follow us on Instagram, Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, Snapchat, and Twitch. We've got content for every platform, so check it out.